Hello, everyone. Today we're going to talk about analytics and infrastructure, not just IT infrastructure, but the real thing, roads and highways and train tracks and bridges. My name is Timo Elliott, and I'm an innovation evangelist for SAP. This is part of a Better Together series of conversations where SAP gives the microphone to our customers and partners for an unfiltered look at how they're innovating with SAP's business technology platform to unlock business value. And I am delighted to welcome Charlie Davies of Costain and Richard Benson of Keytree, now part of Deloitte, to discuss their fascinating data and analytics project to create an intelligent infrastructure control center. So welcome, Charlie and Richard.
Hi. Hi,
Thanks for
Timo.
joining us. Now, the IICC leverages the SAP Business Technology Platform to take comprehensive operations data from UK national infrastructure projects, synthesize all of that data, and put it into a common digital platform. So to tell us more, Charlie, let me start with you. Could you briefly introduce Costain and talk about your role?
Yeah, great to be here, TMO. So my name is Charlie Davies. I'm Strategic Growth Manager at Costain, and my role is around industrializing innovations for delivering better solutions for our clients and customers. Costain, smart infrastructure solutions provider. We're traditionally very much a civil engineering company, but over the last sort of 10 years, we've gone through a transformation. And we are really focusing on delivering better outcomes for our clients and working on projects such as HS2, highways network in the UK, and working with some fantastic progressive bodies such as, oh, I can't say that. Sorry. Can I do that again?
Just we they're working with the biggest organizations in
Yeah,
infrastructure, put it that way.
yeah, yeah. So, Costain, a smart infrastructure solutions provider, and we work on some major projects in UK infrastructure, as well as advising our clients on better outcomes through digital mediums, innovations, but also our engineering expertise and knowledge. And that's where we've really brought value to this platform called the Intelligent Infrastructure Control Center. That's a bit of me.
Great. Richard, over to you.
Yeah, sure. Well, firstly, I'll try and put us in context. So we started working with Charlie back when we were called Keytree. So that was late 2019, early 2020. And that moved on. We did quite a lot of work then halfway through last year. We became part of Deloitte. And now I sit within the Enterprise Technology and Performance team within what they call the SAP Plus. And yet more hierarchy, I sit within the plus bit of that SAP Plus because I look after anything to do with SAP, BTP, particularly intelligent technologies in there. So been working with Charlie and the rest of the team, sort of injecting the AI machine learning pieces into the IICC.
And many thanks to Keytree for being such a wonderful partner over the years, especially in the area of analytics. I know I've seen some wonderful projects that you've done in the past, as well as some really cool, like augmented reality demos and things. So
Always a lot of
if
fun.
anybody's interested in that, go check out the Keytree area of the Deloitte website, presumably.
Flying everywhere.
So Charlie, let me go back to you. So we're bringing together, what kind of data are you bringing together and why? What's the business outcome?
Yeah, so an inherent problem within our business, in our business, in our industry, in our sector is data. So there's a lot of data, but actually drawing out intelligence. What do the business decision makers need to make data-driven decisions and informed decisions? But in real time, we look at with a lot of hindsight, we could have done this better, we could have done that better. A bit of insight saying we're doing this well, but what does that actually mean? The IICC is about, and the use of the BTP platform is about having that real-time insight into different types of data. So whether that's IoT or more static data around your plan and your program, or your commercial data, and even carbon and social value data, it's bringing it all into one place, bringing the data that is needed by the user to make these decisions. So it's really, I would say, this sort of semantic layer to bring the right information to the user to, first of all, identify innovations and efficiencies, to identify performance figures, you know, how are we doing against our schedule, our plan, but also to bring foresight to say, you know, what are my top five risks in this area and how can I be proactive and take, you know, action to deliver this project, this scheme, this, well, whatever it may be, this railway, this highway, in a better way.
So this is across lots and lots of different infrastructure projects. So you're really trying to get one overview of almost everything that's going on across the UK or just within Costain?
No, this is very much UK-based. This is about improving that UK PLC and industry as a whole. So we're a very much UK-focused company, but that doesn't mean that the boundaries are the borders of the UK. When we say across different different sectors, so highways, rail, maybe aviation at some point, I'm not sure, but essentially it's having that minimum subset. I mentioned the user, it's what is that minimum subset that that user needs across the board so that data is not scary, it's not sort of, well, you know, we've got terabytes of data trying to make decisions. It's about refinement and bringing the right insight to that user.
So you really are bringing data across from thousands of different other organizations into one place for better decisions.
Yeah, absolutely. That's the nail on the head. It's about leveraging existing IT infrastructure and joining up. I think that's better together as we call the podcast. So.
Well, I mean, it sounds incredibly ambitious, and I'll get back to that in a second. But let me turn to you, Richard, because I read that part of this is something called a productivity engine. And I saw that you wrote a blog post explaining a little bit what this context is, and I found it was fascinating. So explain to us what a productivity engine is.
Yeah, sure. Well, the platform that the IICC is a fantastic opportunity for innovation, and it's putting all the relevant pieces of information that could possibly be innovated on for a project. And one of the first low-hanging pieces of fruit that we saw was really that there were project plans, whole wealth of project plans. I mean, Costain since 2010 have done hundreds of very large infrastructure projects. So on the one hand, you've got a big set of project plans. On the other hand, you've got a big load of cost data, and you've got productivity, which is a function of how much work you're doing and how much investment you put in versus what you get out. So we saw a great opportunity to say, well, we'll take all of those project plans, we'll understand what the costs were associated with all the different parts of that project broken down into relevant sub-projects. And then we'll try and correlate that to what could possibly affect it. Now, I always use a fairly trivial example of if you're building something, say in the north of Scotland, and it's the middle of winter. Well, guess what? It's often quite windy, and so if you've got a lot of crane work being planned, then guess what? That's going to be delayed. So, trivial example. I mean, the Costain planners are long enough in the tooth that wouldn't be a worry for them. They'd know that already, but it's a good example to communicate to people of, things that can cause the projects that are beyond the control of any one person to then start to cause things to be delayed. Another one could be site access. Traffic jams can stop deliveries coming in, and those deliveries, can be critical, and you can just miss one piece, but that could cause a snowball further down the line that causes, bigger delays. And so you've got to manage those pieces very carefully. So by mining all of that project planning information and all the historic events, everything from weather to geology to site access to soil conditions to anything that could possibly affect the project, we were able to build a platform that's really going to continue to give and continue to be its own innovation platform for researching productivity and predicting productivity. But in turn, that then allows you to when you're planning a project, sit down with the customer and they may be querying, well, why is it more expensive to do the footbridge over the railway line this time? It only cost us a fraction of that last time. Well, it's because, and then you're able to go into a proper dialogue and show them all the moving parts and then interactively plan, because they might say, oh, well, do you know what? It seems to be more expensive because we're building it exactly here. If we move it half a mile up the road, then we don't care, and that makes it a hell of a lot cheaper. And so you can move it to somewhere where there's maybe better soil conditions or whatever's affecting it. And so, yeah, it enables you then to close the loop and have that dialogue with the customer, which enables you to then interactively plan. And once the plan's in progress, also see things that are heading towards you as potential risk, to Charlie's earlier point, and then manage that risk way in advance of it happening. So yeah, really exciting project. We weren't aware of it being done before. So it was a lot of fun to build the foundations of that.
So really data-based decision-making, but at a massive scale. Have put in an innovation award. Folks can read it themselves at sap.com/innovation awards. And it mentions some eye-watering amounts for potential productivity gains. I believe the overall spend on infrastructure is something like £600 billion each year. And you say that it might be up to 30% cost savings over 5 years. So Charlie, how are these benefits already starting to be realized?
Yeah, so we're picking out specific use cases. So Richard mentioned sort of your plan, your commercials, but there's also other areas where things like downtime can be a real issue. You know, the only thing that's less productive than the construction industry is the farming industry. So we really need to level up and meet that leveling up agenda. We've looked at construction machinery, so we call it plant in the UK. I know that's quite internationally, that can not be very well recognised, but the big yellow machines on site, essentially. And we've looked at telematic data and how you can utilise that data to, first of all, look at your utilisation, so your commercials, the productivity, you know, how much time is that machine idling, not being productive, and take proactive actions to really increase that figure. But that also has the knock-on effects around things like carbon. So the less time you're idling, the less carbon impact you have from that. So yeah, we're able to pick out use cases that we're able to scale up across, you know, a massive portfolio of infrastructure projects to really understand the realization of the benefits, the business case, and the return on investments that organizations can see, but also people can see just by being proactive and having that insight and that foresight to make these data-driven decisions.
So the projects are going to be delivered potentially more on time and faster at a lower cost, and it's going to be better for the planet. You make it sound a bit like magic, to be honest.
That's easy peasy.
All right. Well, we're going to turn to some of the, you know, difficulties and challenges you overcame. But first, just nail down which technologies as of the SAP Business Technology Platform did you use as part of this project? Or it might be easier to name the ones you didn't use.
Yeah. I mean, if you look at the Innovation Awards, there's quite a few listed on there. But in terms of the core technologies, so we're using the HANA Cloud environment because of its performance, its pedigree in financial and manufacturing verticals, because, they're the real, they pave the way for how to deliver productivity and efficiency. We're using things like the integration suite so that we can connect into any data source, which is hugely powerful. It really makes sure that there's no boundaries to what we're able to do with the platform. And then there's a lot of integration tools such as smart data integration to ensure that we can process the data. And then we surface that. So this is all about visualization, the user and the user experience. We surface that through the Analytics Cloud, SAP Analytics Cloud product. And yeah, that's really creating that business interface. So a lot of back end to do the processing, but that front end needs to be really simple, really easy to use, and really out of the box for the user. And that's really the philosophy that we've gone by. It's all about making these decisions as straightforward as possible.
So I know you used what you called intelligent data management, so federating data, but not all, if I believe right, not necessarily bringing it all into one place, bringing it in as and when you needed it. Richard, can I turn to you? Any details? I know that's been a sort of holy grail around analytics for a long time, is bringing data in on the fly a little more than building a big data warehouse up front, which sometimes kills the project before you can get started.
Yeah, and one component we made heavy use of and will continue to make heavy use of is SAP's data intelligence platform, which I think started life as Data Hub, right? So it was its primary purpose was to not only bring in enterprise data from inside the organization, but to act as exactly what it says on the tin, a hub for bringing in external data, bringing in, you know, calling other APIs from around the world to bring in my case, you know, bringing in weather data, bringing in soil data from various different places. So, SAP Data Hub data intelligence is going to be critical to that. And particularly the pieces that allow us then to communicate what we're doing. I think one thing we don't want to do is we don't want to deliver this magic black box, which can do a lot of clever data science, but is completely closed and not able to transfer knowledge. So I think nice things within SAC and within data intelligence are it's very graphical. It's very easy to do knowledge transfer for whatever we develop, you know, handing over to the Costain team so that development can continue and innovation can continue. So I think that's a critical piece as well.
So you said SAC, so SAC, SAP Analytics Cloud. So you're bringing all this into a cloud platform, which is presumably a key part of being able to get all of this data. The cloud would seem to be the right environment to do this.
Yeah, absolutely. A big philosophy for us is that we don't store data. So it's all data virtualization, analytics on the fly. And the technology that we're using, you know, market-leading technology, that's enabled us to really push the boundaries of innovation, I think, and create this magic box that we talk about.
Sounds, like I said, almost too good to be true. What were any unexpected challenges or roadblocks? Richard, let me start with you.
Yeah, I think whenever you start these projects, you know, I've been doing this now for well over 10 years of data science projects, and I still fall for it every time. I always imagine the data is going to be there. It's going to be, you know, maybe a bit of wrangling, but, you know, everything that I've heard, it's all going to be true. And it never is. It never is. There's no change, no difference here. You've always got to work at the data. You've always got to, you know, that perfect joining of commercial and project I talked about earlier. You've got to work hard to make that work.
So even though you knew that there would be problems with data quality and data sources, and you'd invested and you put that in the project plan, it was still harder than you thought it was going to be, which is true of most projects.
I think it's always the human factor in it. So, you know, the Costain are incredibly busy delivering A19, Crossrail, all these other things. And access to people is one thing that is absolutely critical. I've got to go in and talk to the program managers, talk to the quantity surveyors, and find out, well, how do you record this particular event? How do you record that event? What does this coding mean? I need, you know, a few hours of quality time. And that, you know, when people are got their head on fire and just trying to deliver, trying to convince them that, you know, it's worth giving you that time because you're going to give them something back which is going to help them down the line, I think is absolutely critical.
And it's worth mentioning you were able to do this project virtually, right? Have you met face-to-face yet?
Never. No. Nope. We haven't seen him through a video screen. So, yeah, we're absolutely desperate to go out and have a celebratory project beer, but not been able to do that. But hopefully soon, hopefully soon.
One of these days. So, Charlie, what about you? Lessons learned or things that other people should take into account when they're next doing their massive dashboard across an entire country?
Yeah, I mean, the first thing for me is to have an open mind. You know, you can be very constrained by what's happened in the past. It's about what's happening now, what's happening in the future, building a resilient solution. The other is to lay firm foundations. So when Richard mentioned access to people, making sure the data's there, you know, that requirements capture phase, that design phase is key to ensuring that when you go into the build and deployment, that things run as smoothly as possible. You're always going to get bugs and hiccups, but being sort of agile to that change is really key. But as long as you have those firm foundations, the right business leaders, the right stakeholder group bought in, it delivers a much better solution. The other part is probably it's about the team. So we work as a very cohesive team to deliver this. Every team member is empowered, and that's been really key to sort of come up with new solutions that we probably didn't expect that we'd go down the route of. So it definitely enables creativity to develop these innovative solutions. So that's a key part of the team are absolutely key to delivering success.
Go ahead, Richard.
Also, a quick add to that is on the team thing. I think our the overall approach of the project to be delivered under Agile also helps energize the team, because you're able to deliver key pieces. Everyone can see something working even early on in the project. And so it just causes more ideas, more dialogue, and more energy in the project overall. So I think, you know, delivering things in an agile way, every 2 weeks, there's another sprint, there's another deliverable, there's another working piece that we can start to draw on. I think it causes people to, and wider stakeholders as well, to actually see something working. So it's not just a pipe dream, it is really there and it's really going.
And Charlie, how about the politics? Because you're holding people's feet to the fire. You're introducing transparency, and you know people can't necessarily fudge the numbers as well as they could in the past. did that not pose any problems?
No, it's definitely a challenge, and it's a challenge that it comes up quite a bit. But I think this is about bringing people on the journey, and Richard mentioned the agile approach. That's about bringing people along on that journey and ensuring that there's high user engagement. It's tackling the areas where we feel like we can make the most progression, showing the benefits, and then that brings the mindset to say, well, actually, yeah, let's explore this new area. So in terms of the politics, the data governance, you know, these different areas, it's first of all, it's been in the design, it's been technical enough to say, well, actually, can we work around this from a technology point of view? And then it's the people side by saying, well, actually, you know, what are people really looking for this? How can we bring them along on that journey? And I think this large stakeholder group having high stakeholder buy-in has really enabled us to progress at pace. You know, as a project, we are ahead of schedule, which is in construction terms, that's an infrastructure. That is a nice place to be.
So strong backers, fantastic benefits, leading edge technology, really is a wonderful project. And we could talk for hours, but that really does, we've run out of time. So it brings us to the end of this session. So thank you so much, Charlie and Richard, for your time. And as I've said, there are more details available at sap.com/innovationawards. And I look forward to joining you again to find out the next phase of the project one day.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Timo.
Watch this space.
and thanks to the audience for joining us. If you'd like to hear more great examples of business technology platform success stories, or participate in the series, or suggest topics, or submit questions for the next live LinkedIn Live Q&A, click on sap.com/BTP to be part of the conversation. And best of luck with your innovation projects, and I hope to see you soon for another Better Together conversation. Please stay safe and goodbye.